Last time, we covered the basics of the pathfinding behavior and set this ball up so it finds its way around these wall objects. This time, we'll cover the properties and some of the events and actions we have available to us when using the pathfinding behavior. In the last video, we talked about the cell size property and how setting it generates a grid during gameplay of cells of that cell size. If the grid cell has a solid object anywhere inside of it, the entire cell will be marked as impassable, and the object will avoid that grid cell. The next property down is cell border, which is currently set to -1. Cell border can be used to adjust which cells are marked as obstacles. Here's an image from Sierra's website, where you can see the effect the cell border property can have on a cell. Basically, this number, which represents pixels, will be added to or subtracted from the edge of the solid object. If it extends into another cell, that entire cell will also be marked as an obstacle. On the flip side, if the number is negative, it can remove cells that are marked as impassable. Let's take a look at it in action. I'll set the cell border to -10. This will cause some cells on the border of the solid object to be marked passable, and the object will be able to travel under them. If I go around this corner, you can see what I mean. If I set cell border to 10, the ball travels around the corner, but gives plenty of room, not going anywhere near the solid wall. That's because extra cells have been marked as impassable. However, if you try to travel up that corridor, the ball won't be able to generate a path. All of the grid cells have been marked as obstacles here. Remember, if multiple objects have the pathfinding behavior, you should set this value consistently between them. Just like with the grid size, using different values between objects will cause Construct to generate another grid and will be much less efficient. So, if you use more than one object with the pathfinding behavior, make sure they use the same cell size and cell border values. The next property is obstacles. There are two options here, solids and custom. This determines what objects will be set as obstacles in the layout. When it's set to solid, all solid objects are considered obstacles. If set to custom, then each object that will be an obstacle must be added as an obstacle in the event sheet. I'll set it to custom and preview the layout. Right now, if I try to generate a path on the other side of the wall, the ball travels straight to the point, going underneath the wall objects. That's because the wall object hasn't been added to the list of obstacles. Let's switch to the event sheet and add a new event. We'll use the system object because we want to add these obstacles at the start of the layout. Although you can add obstacles at any time during gameplay, but if you do, you'll need to run the regenerate obstacle map action. Otherwise, the new obstacles won't be added to the map. For this example, select On Start of Layout. Click Add Action. The ball has the pathfinding behavior applied to it, so we need to add obstacles to it, so select the ball. Scroll down to Pathfinding, and select Add Obstacle. Then, choose the wall object. If I preview the layout, the ball avoids the wall as it travels to the selected point, since the wall has been added as an obstacle. If I add another action, using the ball object, I can use the Clear Obstacles event to remove all objects from the list of obstacles. I don't want to do that now, though. Next, we have Max Speed, Acceleration, and Deceleration. These are all pretty self-explanatory. Max speed is the maximum speed the ball will travel at. Acceleration is how fast the ball speeds up when moving along the path. And deceleration is how quickly the ball slows down. After that is rotate speed. If you notice, when I click on a point, the ball changes direction. It rotates to face towards that direction of the path. The rotate speed determines how fast the object will rotate. If I set it to 600 and preview the layout again, you can see how the ball quickly rotates to the correct angle. Under RotateSpeed is RotateObject. This property determines if the object will rotate at all when traveling along a path. By default, it's set to yes, but if I set it to no, when the object travels around the layout, it stays oriented the same way. It never rotates, even if it changes directions completely. The last property we'll discuss is diagonals. This property lets you determine whether or not a path can contain a diagonal direction. Right now, if I put the ball into this open area and travel down and to the right, the ball goes diagonally, straight to the point I selected. If I set diagonals to disabled and try to travel to the same point, the ball travels to the right until it reaches its first node and then travels down until it reaches the destination point, never using any diagonal angles. And the last thing I'd like to discuss is path cost. You can add objects to the layout which the ball can travel over but will not be the preferred path. On this layout, we have this area here, where if the ball were traveling around this wall object, it could go left or right, and it wouldn't make a major difference in terms of distance. But what if you wanted the ball to try and go left, and only go right if it's a much shorter path? To do that, we can add an object with a path cost. I'll create a new sprite, and name it Rough Terrain. And I'll make it a green square. I'll put it over here and size it up so that it blocks the path completely. Also, with the object selected, I'm going to hold the Control key and drag out a copy of the Rough Terrain object. I'll place the copy in the way of the path over here, where there's only one path the ball can take. Go into the event sheet, and under the OnStart of Layout event, add another action to the ball object, and select Add Path Cost. I'll choose the Rough Terrain object and leave it set to 50. If I preview the layout and travel through the area where there's only one path, the ball goes under the Rough Terrain object. But if I travel over to the other Rough Terrain object, and I try to travel through it, the ball decides to travel around to the other side, avoiding the Rough Terrain. It can be good to indicate to the player that there's a reason why the object doesn't travel over the Rough Terrain, by slowing the object down as it travels over it. First, we need to change the Z order of the Rough Terrain object, since it's above the ball object. We won't be able to see the effect unless we move the Rough Terrain underneath the ball. Right-click on Rough Terrain, go to Z Order, and select Send to Bottom of Layer. Now, switch to the Event Sheet and add a new event. Choose the Ball object, and scroll down to Collisions. Choose Is Overlapping Another Object, and select the Rough Terrain object. Add an action, and select the ball. Scroll down to Pathfinding Movement and select Set Max Speed. I'll set it to 50, so when the ball travels over the rough terrain, its speed is cut to 1/4 of what it usually is. Next, add another event. When the ball isn't overlapping the rough terrain, we want to set its max speed back to 200. To do that, we'll use an else statement. So select the System object, and under Special Conditions, choose Else. I'll copy and paste the Set Max Speed action, and just change the value to 200. Now I'll preview the layout, and when the ball travels over rough terrain, its speed is cut to 25%. Once it crosses over, the speed is returned to 100%. That covers almost everything about the pathfinding behavior, and you should now be able to use this behavior in your projects much more confidently. Thanks for watching. If you found this content helpful, please consider supporting me on Patreon. Comment, like and share this video, and subscribe for more tutorials. See you next time.